Gentlemen, you are tuned into the Status Network, a live TV channel, and this is the Conversation Corner with your host, the author, Andrew Snorton. And just like we do every second and fourth Wednesday about this time, we have a great conversation with some great guests doing some great things across the board. So before we get into our first guest, we got three guests tonight, so this is going to be a real action-packed show. We want to make sure to take care of all of our station announcements as well as public service announcements. First off, with the Status Network, we really appreciate you tuning in to support my show, but the entire Status Network family of television shows, programs, and radio stations. To best enjoy tonight's show, make sure to go to statusnetwork.net on the web, and on the big pop-up box, just click on the Conversation Corner. That way you can see us, get updates, the whole nine yards. For those of you that have space on your smartphones, download the app Status Network. Click on channels, click on live TV, and you're good to go. On your social media platforms of Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, Periscope, and others, make sure to add Status Network as well as live TV. For those of you that have Roku and Amazon Fire Stick, make sure to go ahead and tune in to the Status Network. And again, back on Facebook, you want to make sure you add the host. So go ahead and go to the Facebook page, Author, that's A-U-T-H-O-R, Author Andrew Snorton. And it's already pinned, so you can go ahead, share it, get your watch party set up, and all that. So we are really, really excited to have a great show. Now we're going to go ahead and move into our station as well as public service announcements. So you're aware of different awesome things that are really taking place here, there, and everywhere. So let's go ahead and take a look at Status Network Films. And as you see right here, if you or someone you know, aspiring or established filmmaker, and you want to get your film, documentary, things along those lines, exposure, make sure to check us out at the information provided right there at the very bottom, films@statusnetwork.net. Contact us there. We are definitely looking to make sure that you get the exposure you need for your film or documentary. Our next public service announcement, Emery Rose Photography. They're the best in Gwinnett County, Georgia, the last 2 years. And with Father's Day fast approaching, their special Daddy and Me is a great way to celebrate that dad of yours. But not only that, if you or someone you know is in need of quality headshots and more, make sure to connect with Emery Rose Photography. Our next public service announcement is, these were some of our guests back in March, shouts to This Is Custom for their I Am Black Legacy t-shirt apparel line. As you can see right there, looking at the back, it spells out not only the legacy that you have, but the legacy you can continue to build. So make sure to reach out to This Is Custom on Instagram, Facebook, and other platforms, and help you to build a legacy too. Our next public service announcement is one of our guests. Again, we have some great guests that have been on the show this coming Saturday. This is going to be done virtually, but shouts to the Gwinnett County Chapter of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated. This Saturday, their 5K run walk. As you can see right here, there still might be a little bit of time, but you want to make sure to contact them to be a part of this virtual piece in order to stay fit, health and wellness, and supporting some great causes. Our next public service announcement is one of our guests from last week, Adisa Aaron, shared his powerful story as he beats cancer. So if you see the hashtag Adisa beats cancer, go ahead and take a look at it on your social media platforms. Send him a word of encouragement. They've got a great t-shirt line. Thanks to Daisha's Designs, where a portion of the sales are helping support. And again, shouts to Adisa Aarons and best wishes for tomorrow, hopefully the last of your cancer treatments. Our next public service announcement is I've had a great time the last week or so, ladies and gentlemen. I have to give a shout out to one of our show guests who will be coming on, Cheryl Taylor, who had me as a guest on her radio show. Also want to give a shout to Black Women Read, who had me on their Instagram Live series. And then this past Monday, Talking with Fox, based out of Chicago, Illinois. They are kind enough to have me on. So again, when our media colleagues take time to support us, we got to take time to support them back. So shouts to all three of those groups who allowed me to speak on their platforms. Our next public service announcement is, as a reminder, each and every Wednesday at 1:06 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on my Instagram Live of Author A. Snorton and Facebook Live at Author Andrew Snorton is the Fast 15. It's our weekly checkup, check-in, short reading, and leave you on a word of encouragement. I want to give a shout to Inkman84, who is one of our guests on my show back in February of last year. And he just happened to jump on today. We had a real good talk, real good exchange, making you think and pause and do better and do more. So check us out each and every Wednesday as you see the schedule coming up for the month of June. Our next public service announcement is, as a reminder, I am an author. So of course, what's a better thing to do during this pandemic than read and listen? So make sure you check out 9 Stories of Faith, Volume 1. That's for you or someone you know who draws strength from stories of encouragement and empowerment, people who are living through physical health, mental health, and things along those lines. The other books we'll make sure to circle back to for the poetry fans, which is Deeper Than Your Deepest Sleep, and then for the audiobook fans, The Author's Mixtape. So those are definitely pieces that you want to take advantage of. And finally, we have a quick note from Creative Community Solutions, especially for those people who still have to do the ACT and SAT. Yeah, there's some schools that still require it. So in just a moment, we'll see a short video from them. And after our short video, we're going to go into our very first guests. Hey there, students and parents. As you're aware, due to the pandemic, there are some schools that are waiving their ACT and SAT requirements for the fall 2020 semester. You still want to be in contact with their admissions departments to see the criteria that they are going to use for admission. As for this coming summer, there are test dates for the ACT, June 13th and July 18th. And starting in July of this year, you may register for the fall dates for the ACT. As for the SAT, you can register now as they will start back up with testing in August. But before those test dates come, reach out to us today for your options for individual and group sessions. Virtual sessions are available. And yes, we will preview and prep for the ACT and SAT. So reach out to us today and let's make it happen. And we thank you so much in regards to things. It looks like, hey, we're doing things just slightly a little bit different than what we had planned, but that's okay. So our first guest for today, we've got the one and only Scooter Taylor.
What's going on, man?
Hey, first off, Scooter, thank you for taking and making the time. And thanks, as we did things a little bit differently, but that's okay. Give people a little bit of a point of reference as to where you are from and where you're based out of.
Yeah, no. So I'm currently sitting in Memphis right now. Memphis is the hometown, born and raised here. And so, you know, love everything about Memphis. But I feel like I've been playing Monopoly these past few years. I've kind of went from, you know, Memphis to Atlanta, a little bit of San Francisco, New York, LA. But it feels good to be back home in Memphis here.
Well, I tell you what, frequent flyer miles sounds like that's part of your daily existence.
Exactly. Now,
Scooter,
exactly.
I like to it's hard to really put a label to you because you're so talented in so many different areas. So I'm going to use the broad term social entrepreneur. Walk through with our viewers before getting into quarantine.com. Walk through some of the different projects that you've done, and especially for our 30 and under. Well, really what you're doing is universal, but for that 30 and under, you're doing a bang up job on a lot of stuff. So walk through with our viewers some of the different projects you've been able to work on.
Yeah, no, I think people always think around, what jobs have I done or what's your resume look like? I think I go by projects, right? Like what projects have I been able to work on? And it's a pretty fortunate position, right? To be able to work on a project, right? And not work on a business, right? I think business, if you start too singular about business, right, you kind of limit yourself a little bit as to where it could go, because if you're so worried about revenue and so many just other things that make it a business, right? Who's the CEO and who's the this and the that and the that, the that, right? But like a project is pretty fun. You can work on those, put those on the shelf. So, I'll start with high school. So in this very room that I'm sitting in, I was a YouTuber in high school. So I was making videos on YouTube, reviewing technology products. We had 20,000 subscribers. This is like 2009. And it was starting to make a little bit of money from YouTube videos. Nothing life-changing, but it was really cool. I didn't understand the word monetization probably back in 2009, but to be able to monetize, right, was really impactful. One of the first larger projects was in college. So I went to Morehouse College, and one of the things we did, we attempted to break a Guinness Book World Record, Andrew, for the world's largest water balloon fight. But it was all for charity. And so the idea was like, could we get 12,000 college students together? Could they all donate $5? We break a world record, 12,000 people in the world's largest water balloon fight. But then from there, we raised 60 grand to go build wells in sub-Saharan Africa. So,
wow, I'm going to pause you right there. So, because I think of water balloon fight, and I think of back in my day when, you'd lower the windows of the bus and you would just like throw it, just to see how your reach would go. And if someone accidentally got in the way, that was like a bonus. But yeah, you guys took something like really silly and did something creative with it. Again, just from that, you raised almost about $60,000.
We did. So that's the crazy part, right? What was really interesting is, we were able to do this thing where we actually did not do the water balloon fight. So we actually failed miserably at that. So that was the plan. The plan was to get 12,000 people, go raise 60 grand. And so we failed at that miserably. But we did help 3,000 people get access to clean water. And I think to your overall point is, how do we look at certain of these things that, really are common and bring people together? And to your point, how do we, shape shift them, right, to be something for good, for sure.
Yeah. Awesome. Awesome. So here you are, the college experience. It's where one of those, you just do it to sometimes see if you can. But
yeah, totally.
From that, you're able to take some of the best of what you do there and apply it towards other projects. What were some other projects that you feel are a bridge to this real big one that you're doing with quarantine.com?
Yeah, no. The last 4 years, right? So, we did college. And then after college, I got the chance to go start, another business or another project. But this one was more of a business, right? This one was like, we're doing a technology startup company and we have investors from Silicon Valley. Like, that's how we started it, right? So we started off the game with like investors, like Y Combinator. We had Comcast as an investor. Morgan Stanley ended up being an investor. So I was CEO of that company for about 3.5-4 years. In the midst of it, I thought I was doing terrible and I didn't know why, like, woe is me, why am I going through these hard problems? But, I'm now learning that it was all a really big learning experience on two fronts, right? I think I learned a lot of things around just working with other people. I think everyone thinks they can work with other people until they're forced to. And so obviously in a small startup environment, you're with your co-founder and with your team every day. And so you see their shortcomings, you see their successes, you see the whole person. And sometimes seeing the whole person means you have to see their shortcomings or you have to see the parts where they fail. And so learning to not, not be selfish or a, you know, just a brat and say like, oh, because you did not get this assignment done on time, or because you couldn't, you know, reach the goal that we wanted, you know, I'm mad at you, right? How do you extend grace to that person and say, okay, well, it's okay, we'll get better tomorrow, right? Because this is a long thing, you know, like building a company that's going to be worth $1 billion one day, that does not happen overnight, as much as anybody wants it to be. You know, it takes, you know, at least 5 years before you probably really even start seeing a little bit of traction. And then after that, you know, there's another probably 13 years, right, before you get to the IPO, you know, stage, right? I mean, it takes time. And so I think that was a big thing that I learned. I think I also learned a lot around just self-discipline and kind of working on self. And so realizing, you know, when I start to create a daily routine for myself, maybe other things get better, right? When I start to create a budget for myself, those habits carry over into my business, right? And so if I'm scared to look at my own personal bank account because it's, you know, getting close to $50, I'm probably also scared to lift the hood up under the business and say, oh, we're not going to have money for payroll in 4 weeks, you know? And so a lot of those things that are very transferable. And so I think to your point now, starting Quarantinecon, it's just like all those lessons are just like in the, like they're in action right now. You know, I think about Mr. Miyagi, like, you know, wax on, wax off, and, you know, he's doing this stuff and he's like, why am I doing this? And he punches him and he's like, poof, you know, like boom, like, you know, that's why you did that, right? Because when you see the punch, you know how to block. I think, you know, I did that first company. So now with Quarantinecon, man, we are moving at lightning speeds. And, you know, maybe some of the doubt and the worry and the anxiety and the overthinking about things that I had 4 years ago, I'm like, nope, you know, look at it, assess it, make a decision, let's move on. And so it's been beautiful.
And I tell you what, and just seeing the growth, because you launched this, correct me if I'm wrong, you really launched this back in March, like the right. official, I'll say, first big event. But you've got such a big umbrella in such a limited time, whether it's employment pieces, startup, venture capital, even getting involved in the civic process. So walk through with our viewers since March. And this is really a culmination of really the lessons learned from different projects, as you like to speak. Walk through under the umbrella, what are some of the key things that have already been done and what's on the horizon?
Yeah, no. So I think to give everyone context, you know, the next project, the current project, right, is called Quarantinecon. To Andrew's point, you know, it was March 13th. I came to Memphis on March 13th. My mom had a birthday. And so I came to fly in thinking it'd be a 2-day trip, maybe 3 days. So I only came with a carry-on bag and I got stuck, you know, via quarantine. And so one of my good buddies, the same buddy, right, that I did the water project with, right? So as you can see, there's a little bit of a trend here. But he reached out and said, hey, I'm going to a digital conference. Come check it out. Within minutes, I'm blown away. And I'm like, we should throw this for Black creatives and entrepreneurs and just people in general, right? Because we felt that we knew so many people like in New York or LA and Atlanta, and like this time that we're having at home that now they're telling us don't leave our house for a few days. Like, we can't just let this go to waste, right? We can still network and connect. And we found this technology, to your point, that like is used for one thing, but we could shape shift it to be a digital conference. Like, let's go do that. We thought 500 people would show up, 4,000 people showed up. And so, we woke up the next day going, okay, we got 4,000 people here. You know, what do we do next? And again, instantly going into the mode, we said, okay, like we need to go create relevant programming for all these people. And so let's think about it. There's a recession happening. People won't need to know about finances. So we brought in wealth advisors. Hey, there are some people that are on this 4,000 person list that are trainers, they're fitness trainers. Oh, that means some people need to let's create a virtual gym, which allows the trainer to now work out our community, but our community has to go pay that trainer $5 to participate. So now what happens? Now we're cash apping our trainer friends and people that we don't even, you know, we're cash apping them $200 because they just, you know, worked out a few different people. So that was exciting. We did a culinary showcase where we brought on people and, you know, no more making chicken Alfredo every day during the quarantine. So we brought on some chefs, and world renowned chefs, yes, to talk about the culinary business, but also like our peers, right? Young 20-year-olds who are starting culinary businesses. Three more that I want to really hit on really quickly. One being the mental health day. That was a really exciting day, where we brought on, therapists and doctors, and allowed people to have like really intimate sessions and learning just more about themselves. We did that when the first day of May. So we kicked off Mental Health Awareness Month with that one, which is exciting. Second and third, we did a career fair and a pitch competition. So again, the idea of how do we create something super relevant for the people in our community, right? They may be losing jobs, there are people losing internships. What happens if we do a career fair and someone gets hired, right? And so that was exciting. Again, a pitch competition. There are people in our community that are entrepreneurs. What can they be doing during this quarantine? What if they could actually get access to capital, right, for their business? And we can reward their creativity and their ingenuity for continuing to hustle on a business in the midst of a pandemic, right? That is very, very tough. And so we awarded over $50,000 to Black startup founders. And then, most recently you hit on civic engagement. We're saying, okay, what can our people be doing to really make sure change happens in this country? And we think one way to do that is making sure they're voting and making sure we're encouraging others to vote. And so we thought about this idea around phone banking. And I think we've all probably received a pesky phone call before from a phone banker.
Yeah.
But that is a really effective way to still get in front of voters, right? And so, you're not just calling saying, hey, vote for Joe Biden, right? We're not doing that. We're calling voters, mainly Black and Brown voters, saying, number one, are you registered to vote? Number two, do you know where your polling place is? Number three, did you know you can vote by mail? You don't even have to leave your house. Hey, number four, did you get your absentee ballot? Why didn't you get it? Okay, let me make sure I set that up so you actually get it before the deadline. Wait, number five, did you know you can vote? You think you can't vote because you were recently, or you have something on your record? Your rights actually may have been restored and you can actually vote. These are things that traditionally just people don't know. I think we take it for granted that we maybe know some of these things. And so can the young people, older folks, the 10,000 people that have come to our events, it's fun to come to a culinary showcase and learn how to make mixed drinks. It's very beneficial to interview with Morgan Stanley for a job for yourself. But, can we take an hour out of our day and make phone calls to America, Black and Brown people in America, and let them know to vote? So that's where we are. Long answer, I'm sorry, but
no.
We've done all of that, and to your point, we've done all of that, and I guess it's been, it's coming up on 10 weeks, 11 weeks now.
I tell you what, no, I'm glad you went in depth. You hit so many key points during this time. And so when I really get around and say social entrepreneur, it's not just the social gatherings. It's not just business and entrepreneurship. It's sure. civic engagement. For so sure. As we get ready, I'd love to, but I know I got two other guests I got to try to
get. Yeah, through. No.
Look. Before we transition to our first commercial break, could you please let our viewers know the best ways to connect with what you're doing through quarantine.com with this current project?
Yeah, no. I think for us, it's our goal to continue to create programming and events, while we have this time sheltering in place. And so you can always kind of learn when the next event is by following us on Instagram. I know it's a cliche place to follow us, but quarantinecon.co. Is the Instagram. And if you go to that same quarantinecon.co, that's the website, you can actually see some of the videos that we have from a lot of our events. So you can still catch up on the information. And then on the off chance, there's anyone in the audience that just wants to connect with me and talk more, or they have an idea, because a lot of these events not are just us, right? It's actually people in the community going, I want to go do this, right? Last night, we actually had an HBCU networking night where over, almost 300 people from HBCUs came out and not even, it was a mix of people and they were networking and talking. So my email is just Scooter. And I'll give you the personal, how about that? Scooter@scootertaylor.com. So it's easy, but that's my email.
That's I tell you what, Scooter, thank you so much for taking and making the time. Continue well wishes, my friend, with all you're working on. What we're going to do right now is take a short commercial break, and we come back, we're going to bring on our second guest, Ms. Cheryl Taylor. So stick around on the Conversation Corner with your host, the author, Andrew Snorton.
I'm with it.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we hope everyone's having a good time so far. A great lead-in with Scooter Taylor. And now our next guest, no relation to, from what I understand, but this is one of the people that I had featured in the opening with our announcements. And anytime you get a chance to connect with people, you know, in media, it's a wonderful thing. I had a great time this past Thursday on the Cheryl Taylor Show, and now Turnabout is Fair Play. So Cheryl, how are you doing this fine evening?
Hi, I'm good. How are you? You hearing me good?
Yeah, hearing you just fine. Look, we hear you, we see you, life is good. Give our viewers a little bit of a background where you are originally from, where you are mainly based out of, but I know where you're mainly based out of is different from where you are right now.
Yes. Well, I am Cheryl Taylor, and I am originally Trinidadian, born from the beautiful island of Trinidad and Tobago, where I am here currently because of the pandemic. But I reside in New York, in New Jersey, in the United States. So I'm here, you know, of course, you know, we're stuck here for a while, but it's been fun. Home is home. So we're still doing wonderful things from here. As you know, it's forced us to do things a little differently, but yeah.
Yeah, doing things a little differently has definitely been the operative term. Now, before you decided to tap into, you know, what I think you have a great gift and great talent into event hosting and radio, because you walked through with our viewers some of the things you were doing before.
Before, I actually was in banking for like 15 years. And whilst doing that, I also performed from in the U.S. with a group called Cheryl Byron and Something Positive. It was a passion. I did theater and dance for many years with that wonderful company, who is now run by Michael Manswell, who is now the artistic director. And from doing that, I realized I had a passion for theater, for hosting, for a little comedy in between. And so I started doing a little real talk on Facebook, and it got to be pretty cool. And then that kind of branched off into a couple years later, doing my little motivational speeches, which I still do, of motivating women of color, you know, the younger generations, to just, you know, empower women who are looking to do things and who are actually looking for like big sisters, more or less. So, you know, it's that like a big sister program I kind of started, and was getting so much of emails and inboxing of situations. That's when that's basically how, after the Cheryl Taylor Show came up, the online radio show.
Awesome. So it's great. So here you are, from corporate to basically, you know, doing events, also giving back in regards to mentorship and outreach, which is awesome. Let me ask you this, and this is something I ask just about every guest. When did you know it was time for you to pivot, to go a little bit deeper? Because, you know, hosting events is cool, but obviously there is something in you that says, I need to step up with this. What would you say was that pivotal moment?
That came for me when I did a show out in New Jersey, and I was asked to host that show. And when I was done hosting the show, a lot of people came up to me and said, hey, you know, you're really good at this, you know. And I said, you think so? And they said, why don't you start doing some more? And what I did was, actually, I started doing more things on Facebook. And as people started to reach out to me a little more, especially the younger generation. And from doing that also, to be honest, from traveling, I travel a lot. I saw different things as far as hosting was fine, but I also got into work as, I don't know how to call it, missionary in a sense, where I was seeing so much of poverty of people of color, and, you know, people are really struggling really out here. So I founded a non-for-profit organization called Soldiers for Change. And that is what we wanted to do with that, which was really doing change and making hampers, feeding the homeless, helping families who are, you know, underprivileged. And we've been doing that for the past 5 years now. It's been really rewarding. I love traveling, but everywhere I travel and I see poverty in different forms, and not just people on the streets, but people are living, because I always say some of us are living like one paycheck away from being homeless.
Oh yeah.
and that's real. That's so real. Like, it's so real out here. And when you see the, you know, how people work hard, but just trying to make ends meet, you know, I came back and said, wow, I have to do something. And that's how, again, Soldiers for Change was founded. I had a platform, so I started to do online the radio show. I started to host events, and within hosting events, started to still, at the end of it, you know, let them know they can go and donate, and, you know, and so we can keep this going, keep our care packages going, keep the feeding going, keep the monetary things that we can give. We also work with Elizabeth Coalition for the Homeless in Elizabeth, New Jersey, where we did a couple of Christmas programs. I've cooked for them, for the kids, for the Christmas holidays, and I do that. I try to do it every year. Or we donate the, you know, toys and so forth for the children. So we came to Trinidad actually and did a big thing, because we had about 2 years ago, there was a flooding here, and we came down here and we did packages, feed the homeless, gave care packages to families and things like that. So, you know, I encourage anyone to use the platform, you know, to, once you can spread word, once you can help, once you can do something, and that's what I've been doing. Instagram have started, as you said, you know, with the pandemic, and me being stuck down here, I had to find a way, because I was getting inboxes. Cheryl, oh gosh, I miss you. How are we going to do it? And I have this problem. So I started Night Chat with Cheryl T. This is, you want to guess this last week. Night Chat with Cheryl T. We talk about everything and keep it 100.
Well, I tell you what, the thing that I love, and it's great, because even Scooter mentioned it before, that advocacy piece, and there's different ways you can advocate. So with,
yes,
in regards to homeless and during the holidays, it's great that even as you're making your movement, you're not forgetting there's other people that, quote, you want to help move with you. That's really huge. And another thing, like you said, and being growing up in New Jersey myself, Asbury Park, I got to technically mention Randolph, because I'll hear it from the kids I went to elementary school with in Ocean Township, but Jersey, cool, basically, Monmouth County. Yes. But it's great what you said, because like you said, normally you're in the radio, you know, you're in the radio station or in the booth. And because of, like I said, with the pandemic and where you are, you're still taking inventory of things around you to still be that resource. And I can tell folks point blank when I was fortunate to be on last Thursday, and I tell you what, we covered a whole lot of ground. But I think the thing, and I think viewers can get it right now, engaging personality and just genuine and a great spirit and a great vibe and all this type of thing. What would you say, and you kind of talked about it with right now the pandemic, you're making adjustments where you're still doing your show. Yes. What would you say is one of the biggest things you have learned as part of your journey with hosting and radio?
Ooh, one of the biggest things I've learned, take nothing for granted. And I say that because, you know, sometimes we feel like, oh, maybe we have arrived, or, but every day we're learning. Every day I go to a different place, or I go to, whether it's uptown, downtown, you know, you learn something every day about people and different energies and personalities. And so I've learned to take nothing for granted in this life of doing what I do. And I'll give a quick example. A friend of mine called me, and whilst I was here, we put some things together to give for a family. Now, I won't say they're not homeless or anything, but, you know, because of the situation, everybody's been going through certain things. And when I went to her, I gave her about maybe like three hampers, you know, put together about two different set of stuff. And just when I was walking off, she said to me, "Cheryl, can we pray?" And I said, "Excuse me?" She said, "Can we pray?" And she was so grateful. Tears came to her eyes because, you know, in this time, in this pandemic, she didn't have anything and she had three children, you know. And, you know, she looked at me as an angel. I said, "But no, we have to always know that we can't put tear down each other, but uplift each other. And if you're in a situation and I'm here that I can help, that's what I do." If you feel me, I don't feel like I'm too, you're never too big or too small. Once you can help and you have a platform and you can help someone, that's what you do. So for my journey here, especially with this pandemic, it's taught me that, you know, don't take nothing, because your life can change in an instant like this, like that, you know, without no warning. You know, everything that you know can just dissipate and you have to rebuild again.
I tell you what, it's true. And like you said, in the blink of an eye, like, things can definitely change and definitely pivot. Now, with the adjustments you're making, with the perspective that you have, let me ask you this. Now, of course, you don't know how long you're going to be where you are, but if it looks like you're going to be there a little bit longer, are you reaching out to radio stations there, or is it more so, are you going to stick with what you're doing right now with your platforms, and then, quote, when it's safer to come back, get back on track when you go to New Jersey? Have you kind of given that some thought?
Well, I have, but the thing is, I was actually a guest on WAC Radio 90.1, big up to WAC. And also I did a segment, I was a guest also on 102.1 with Sir Charles, and I had a wonderful time. And, you know, the energy was nice, the vibe was nice, because I love broadcasting. I love, you know, I love radio. I love it. That's my passion. I love it. And so I was looking at that here because, you know, I was thinking of being here for a little while, and you never know what can happen. So this is a thought of being here. Also, being in this pandemic made me, you know, be able to do more projects. I have my book I'm in the middle of doing, The Choices I Made. I did my motivational CD. I did actually finish three of them. That should come out probably beginning of the year. And, you know, we're also doing a small television project that I'm doing. So it's allowed me to really broaden my horizons and broaden the way in which I see things and the way I, in my projects, how it's all coming together. You know, just being home every day on the computer, learning. And, you know, as far as online go, Night Chat with Cheryl T, that's why I did it, because, of course, I'm stuck down here. So mm-hmm. Night Chat with Cheryl T, just a way to stay connected to people and to my audience.
And I tell you what, you have dropped a lot of gems, a lot of nuggets. What would you say this? And I know we've got one more set of guests we got to get to, but let me ask you this last quick thing before we close out your segment. one piece of wisdom or insight? You've dropped a lot, but what's one other theme you want viewers to take away to be like, if I don't remember anything else, remember this?
What I want you to, if you take nothing else, is to remember that in sometimes when we fail at things, remember that failure is only the setup for your success. And I want you to always go with that. Failure is only the setup for your success. So if you go and you didn't get through, don't think it's the end. Don't think that I can't do this. Don't think it's not going to happen. Just remember, it's going to take a different route. Just take a different route, but you're still going. Just keep going, keep focused, because that failure is only going to build you and get you stronger for your success. Every setback is for a greater comeback.
That is awesome. That's awesome. Let's do this real quickly. Let our viewers know the best way to stay connected with you.
Oh, you can stay connected to me on Instagram at I am Cheryl Taylor. Also on Facebook at I am Cheryl Taylor. Twitter at I am Cheryl Taylor on Facebook. Twitter is The Cheryl Taylor Show. Instagram, The Cheryl Taylor Show. My apologies, Cheryl Taylor Show. You can get me on there. And also on the website at soldiersforchange.org, where if you want to go and donate and see what we're about, what we're doing, feel free to go on there at soldiersforchange.org.
Okay, well, what we're going to do is we're going to take a quick commercial break. And we come back, we're going to close out with our last guests who are really putting this social and community advocacy to the forefront. So let's go ahead and take that commercial break for just a quick moment on the Conversation Corner.
No problem. Have a great evening.
And ladies and gentlemen, we are back on the Conversation Corner. I know we are moving at lightning pace today when we have three guests doing some great things. This is part of what we do. Now, this past Friday, as not only in a number of places in Metro Atlanta, but really throughout the country, as we've seen, there's been a rise in regards to awareness, consciousness, and advocacy, and especially in looking at issues related to law enforcement. You think about the cases taking place in Minneapolis, Louisville, Kentucky, Indianapolis, Brunswick, Georgia, and more are coming out behind the woodwork. It's great to see the community advocacy taking place, but even better is, as you've seen right here, when you're around people with a lot of energy, a lot of passion, and a lot of purpose, that's even better. So this past Friday, I was really excited and fortunate to be able to cover one of the protest rallies that took place in Kennesaw. I know we should have, I think we have both, but I know we definitely have one of our folks who was behind the scenes, Mr. Adam Ashley. So Adam, if you can go ahead and join in with us, how are you doing tonight?
I'm good.
Okay, good. Yeah. First off, thank you for your time. Thank you for your patience. Let our viewers know where you are based out of.
Well, right now I'm in Kennesaw, Georgia for school, but I'm from Grayson, Georgia. And well, I was born in New Jersey, came to Grayson, and that's where I went to high school, and now I'm here.
Okay, so New Jersey is definitely in the house. So now let me ask you this, Adam. As a college student, you're there to take care of your business, obviously connect with the community at different points. But let me ask you this, for you and your colleagues from Josiah and everybody else, what would you say was that impetus to take your advocacy to the next level?
Well, we had gone out to, it was a Kennesaw march to downtown, like from KSU to downtown Kennesaw. And that's when we went in front of that Waldman store, which was basically the Confederate store that promoted all of like the racist memorabilia from the Ku Klux Klan to old records by Johnny Rebel. And we had gone out there and we were talking to the owner, and he just showed us that in his head, what he was saying was right, and that there's no wrong in his beliefs of how the KKK is not a racist group and is just a hate group and stuff like crazy stuff like that. And later on that day, I had left, but Josiah was there, and one of the workers from the store actually pulled a gun on a black girl that's a student at KSU that was at the protest as well. And after that, I texted him, and we were talking about it, and I was like, we need to go out and go again to really send a message to not only them, but the people that were with us protesting. Because I felt like when we were out there, we marched, yeah, but there was a lot of people on Twitter talking about, why don't we just burn the store down? We should just go back and burn the store down. And like I was telling you, that burning the store down isn't gonna help our situation. What would help our situation is going out to vote for people that have our best interests in mind. Because in Kennesaw, Georgia, a lot of people that are in office right now, well, in Cobb County, a lot of people that are in office right now do not have a problem with that store. So that's the main message that I was trying to address to people.
And I'm glad you said that. First off, that incident is very, I'll say, unfortunate. And I hope for the person who is, you know, victimized, I hope they're doing as well as possible. The second thing is this, when you all came back, and I was able to be there for a few hours, and I know we didn't get a chance to connect them. You were working. That's all I'm saying. You were out there working. You were on the bullhorn. You're like, look at here, y'all. But walk through with our viewers what made last Friday so important. I have my take on it, but I want the viewers to hear from you.
What made it so important was it was right before the election, which was yesterday, and it was basically letting people know how important the election was on Tuesday, because you see on the news and stuff, people burning buildings down, saying that they're mad, but it comes to a point where we see throughout history, well, throughout these most recent years, people get mad and then they protest. And then after that, everything goes back to the same thing. So to really change from what has been going on, so what we actually want is that people need to go out and vote. Like, we can protest as much as we want, but one of the main things that will help us is going out to vote for people that are going to help, that want to help us.
And one of the good things about this past Friday, and I was there from about 1:30 until about 4, you guys were very aggressive with every time you had a chance to talk. You were not only stressing how important it is to vote. And I don't know if we'll have time to show one of the video clips. We might not, because we're really getting close. But you were really strong by saying, hey, look, if you don't want that type of stuff to go on, you have to be registered to vote. You have to vote. You have to be aware of people's platforms, because you pointed out part of the reason he's there is that someone had interests that were similar to his, and that's why he's there. So I want you to really stress that message, because you also had sample ballots out for people.
Yeah, and Josiah had the idea of bringing out the sample ballots, and I was stressing the fact that people needed to go on ballotready.com. It's a website that me and my roommate Paul used right when we went to vote, like right before the election. I mean, right before the protest, we did early voting that Friday, and right when right before we went into our booth, we were just looking on our phone at the ballot that we pre-made with all the people that, because it shows you everybody that would, like, everybody that has the same beliefs as you and the same views as you, that you would vote for. So we just went through our pre-made ballot and just clicked those people quick and easy. So that's why we were both stressing, look at the sample ballot, look at the ballotready.com, and like utilize the resources that we have so we can make a change.
And another thing, and you guys honestly did a great job reminding people of that, reminding people of those resources. But I think another thing that was awesome was it was great to see college age people taking the lead, but you guys had a broad cross section of people, generation wise, ethnic background wise. Do you have a general idea maybe about how many people were there? I think you had probably at least 400 to 500. You might have had more.
I'm not really certain on how many people were there, but yeah, I don't really know. I think around 400 to 500 about, but it was like different. There were whole families coming out to support what we were doing. I have this picture I posted on my Instagram story of this kid that was like going like that and just like helping the cause and stuff. So it was really great to see all of like everybody out.
And not only that, and our viewers need to know, like, you guys got support from not only the businesses when you were out marching, they were handing out water. Even some of the people you had speak, you had the police chief of the Kennesaw Police Department, and they even donated water. But another thing that you guys did, which is what you said before, you gathered all these people with all this energy, and you started dropping nuggets as to how individually and collectively people can take it to the next step. What types of things do you guys see yourselves doing to continue to get that momentum going and keep people engaged?
Well, right now we're working with some other people on a march on June 14th that's basically going to include all of the USG colleges. So we're trying to get Georgia State, I forgot what, like Morehouse, all those other colleges around to come to Kennesaw and march around Kennesaw. And after that, we're doing a Juneteenth cookout and right in Kennesaw at Swift Control Park. And we're going to have some people come out and just speak and talk about the importance of voting, like we've been talking about, and the importance of just staying politically aware and socially aware of what's going on in your community. Because we don't want this to be like something that people just went out to go protest because everybody was protesting, and then after that, they're just like, I'm done with it. No one else is doing it anymore. So why do I care that much? I'm just going to be mad by myself. Like, that's what we don't want to happen. So we're going to try to keep on pushing this.
And the key thing is, like I said, even at the time I was there, you're like, look, you still have to be able to do A, B, C, and D. And it sounds like you're going to keep those types of components in place. Do you, as the summer and even as the fall comes back, do you think, and I'm just throwing it out there, maybe forums where you bring in the different candidates running for, let's say, the local offices, do you see maybe people from the voting office walking through how you get registered and things along those lines?
Yeah, that's actually like something that I was thinking about earlier too, about having like just showing people the process of voting. Because I worked the voters poll yesterday, and a lot of people were confused on the new way that they were doing it with the new machines and stuff. So I feel like people need to be more educated on how you actually vote before you just go vote. Because you go there and you see a big touch screen of a whole bunch of names that you don't really know, and then you just start clicking stuff, and then you bring the person the ballot and just leave, and you don't really know exactly what's going on. And me, Josiah and I are also working with somebody that's running for House of Representatives in Ackworth and Kennesaw area. His name's Kyle Renato, and we're going to have him come out. I'm going to talk to him on coming out to our Juneteenth cookout.
Well, I tell you what, and I know I wish we had more time. I know we've got a show coming on, probably about like 5 minutes, like right after us. So number one, I appreciate your patience with today. Number two, I appreciate you sharing your story. Number three, it's clear that you've got an action plan of taking this energy and moving it into constructive action. What would you say for the upcoming events this Saturday and for Juneteenth? What are the best ways that people can find out and stay connected?
The best ways are either Josiah or my Instagrams. And my Instagram is AdamN.00. Or you could find me on Twitter at Adam00ASH.
That sounds good. And I know, like I said, we've got to make sure that we wind down since we've got another show coming on after us at 8. But Adam, and definitely Josiah, who's on for a little, but I know he had to bounce. Thank you. Continue to move forward and continue to use your resources the way that you are. So what we're going to do, ladies and gentlemen, as it's getting close to 8, we've got another show coming up. We want to thank you for taking and making the time to be on the Conversation Corner. We bring in a little bit of everybody. We covered a whole lot of ground in a limited amount of time, but please don't let this be the last time that you connect with our guests and the great things that they're doing. So you can catch us next on June 24th at about this time. We're going to go ahead and call it a show. But in the meantime, to each and every one of you guys, please take good care, continue to be great, and we will see you real soon.